How are you?
Yeah, good, Jack. No worries.
If you don't know me, my name is Jack Buckskin. I'm a Kaurna Narunga and Wirangu man. I want to take the opportunity to thank everybody for allowing me to come here today to provide a welcome to country. Relearner of my language, so every opportunity I get to speak it, it's always good. I'm also going to play a bit of the didgeridoo, so I'm going to pay respects to the traditional owners of the didgeridoo, the Yolngu people from Arnhem Land, for allowing us to play their instrument. And I might as well plug their the Yiriki exhibition down at the museum. If you haven't checked it out, get down to the South Australian Museum. You'll get a real understanding of what the didgeridoo actually is. So in saying that, I want to reintroduce myself and then welcome us through a song. And I've got these, my son's boomerangs here. He's fake boomerangs because he steals all my clapsticks. So we've done a little trade with my son and I. So. This one, I just want to introduce myself and then go into the welcoming song and then play a bit of the didgeridoo. Ngānaru pinchini ye tika gani ngukua pranakuna wicha bakani ngāi tangi wuta gana naranga wirangu miu. Maru wicha nga ngaichu bukiana, porkana kumakana mini ye yala ranga wanga di mani na budni ngadluku yātana. Ngadluku yunga ndalya yakana dalya. Mani ngadlu tampan di ngadlu gani yātanga tika ndi henti yātanga ngadlu tanda ganya taka ndi kuma. So I just said, half of that was just saying my name is Kaurna Ngukua Pinakudna, which Kaurna, it's my totemic name, which is the rock. My newest name is from my son. He's Ngukua, the barking owl, so I've become Ngukua Itpina, the father of the barking owl, and Kudna, which tells you I'm a third born male in my family. And after that, I was just saying that it's always good that we acknowledge that we're meeting on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, and when we travel, acknowledging whoever the traditional owners are as well. So and into that a little bit more, this part here we call Tāna Ganya, which is a little bit different to the area I'm from as well. So in saying that, I want to welcome you all to country through this song, which is about acknowledging our ancestors and the country around us and the people.
Thank you.
throw it back over Farron. She's doing a good job, Farron. Keep it up. And for the rest of the years, enjoy the rest of the time here. Gajalia, nakara.
Now, I know you already thanked Jack, but can we do it again? Because he was really great. And now I'd like to invite the Right Honourable Lord Mayor of the City of Adelaide, Martin Hazy, up to formally open the Live Music Summit.
I thought I might need to climb up on stage in front of you all there. Welcome everyone, a very special welcome to the City of Adelaide, a proud UNESCO City of Music, and welcome to today's Live Music Summit, which of course is a first for Adelaide and a first for South Australia. I'd also like to begin by acknowledging that we meet on Kaurna land and that we pay respect to elders past and present, and we thank Jack Buckskin for his wonderful welcome to country. And for those that are in Adelaide for the first time, the welcome to country is an incredibly important and historically significant. It happens when we open all of our public meetings. And it's extraordinarily important for not only us as South Australians and as an Australians, but also important for us to extend that welcome to you. So thank you very much, Jack. Now, I'd like to welcome, we've got a number of people here today, but I'd like to welcome, and I'm meeting the Mayor of Katowice a little bit later today, and I'm not sure if the Mayor's here yet, but Marcin Krupka from the city of Katowice in Poland, which is one of the great UNESCO cities of music, and I have a meeting with the Mayor in my office in a couple of hours' time. Tammy Franks, MLC, our Deputy Lord Mayor, Megan Henders, joining us today, Councillor Sandy Wilkinson and Councillor Philip Martin. All of our international guests, a very warm welcome to Adelaide. You are here at a wonderful time. It really is a great time in the February-March period in the City of Adelaide. It's a great time to celebrate. There is so much to do, and please do enjoy. Peter Luca, the Executive Director of Arts South Australia. Sarah Bleeby, Director of the UNESCO City of Music in Adelaide. Anne Weiberg, Chair of Music SA. And our panel members, who will be with us soon. Raina Kern, Director of UNESCO City of Music from Mannheim in Germany. Raina, welcome. John Wardle, Director, National Live Music Office. Hannah Brooks, Business Advisor of the City of Melbourne, welcome. Beck Bates, Manager, Contemporary Music Arts South Australia. We've got our Director, Claire Mockler. We've got our Associate Director, Sean McNamara. And everyone, a very special welcome to you. It's great to have you here. Now, a few things to celebrate, and I think that's really important when it comes to live music in the City of Adelaide and right across South Australia, is we celebrate the things that we're doing spectacularly well. And yesterday, the Grace Emily Hotel, of which many of you would frequent, know and love, won a very, very special award. So it was inducted into the South Australian Music Hall of Fame. Now, I think the word that comes to mind when you think about the Grace Emily is authenticity. Authentic food, authentic people, authentic live music, and authentic atmosphere. And the Grace Emily does that spectacularly well, and I think it's an absolutely terrific and very, very fitting acknowledgement for the Grace Emily. Because not all venues need to be gentrified in order to be great. When you look at authenticity and that relationship between it and live music, I think there's a very, very important segue between both. And also, no poker machine. So it's a great pub, and I hope you support it. The music, I think, is kind of one of humanity's greatest forms of self-expression. There are so many benefits associated with music, with live music, with recorded music, with the creative capital that is in Adelaide and that is in South Australia. And there's this growing body of work around the world in terms of the medicinal, the therapeutic benefits of music for people of all ages. So I think that Adelaide's becoming a UNESCO City of Music is a great recognition for this city. We join a very unique family, a handful of cities around the world who celebrate all forms of music, fine music included, because it's so important, I think, to Adelaide's DNA. It's very important to our identity. Our creative capital is so important to defining who we are as South Australians. Who remembers their first live music gig? And I think there's something special. I've got a few hands up. But I think, you know, that memory of your first live music gig, and I think mine was probably about 1983 when I saw the Machinations play at Adelaide Uni. And then I think I saw NXS play at Memorial Drive. And they just put out their first album, probably in about 1985. But those kind of memories, you just never forget them. So live music kind of really becomes part of our, you know, our past, our present, and our future. I think it's kind of very, very special. Now, the City of Adelaide has a very simple four-point plan for our city, which I have great pleasure in communicating to everybody. But we want to be a smart, green, livable, and creative city. And if you think about those four key words for Adelaide, smart, green, livable, and creative, you can all identify something in there which you're passionate about and what that means in terms of your future in our city. And like I was sharing before, our creative capital is so important to our identity. So that creative city and live music are just like that. Our arts community, live, performance, dramatic, film, all of the above is so important. And to have a creative city, in fact, I believe you can't actually do anything without being a creative city. We talk about entrepreneurship, we talk about innovation, we talk about so many things. But the source of all of that surely is creativity, because creativity is all about trying new things, embracing new ideas. And whether that's in areas of social responsibility, corporate, the arts, it all starts with actually being creative and doing things differently. So again, the importance of Adelaide as the UNESCO City of Music just cannot be underscored. City of Adelaide has a live music action plan, which is 2012 to 2016. We're in the process of reviewing that, and that'll come back to the councillors mid this year, and that'll give us a roadmap from now through to about 2020. So we take this really seriously. We take our partnership with the state government when it comes to the UNESCO City of Music very, very seriously. We thank the state for their support. So today's panel discussion is going to be terrific. It's going to be very interactive, and I know that everyone will get a great deal out of it. So thank you for your contribution today. It's wonderful to see you all here. And please, locally, nationally, and internationally, spread the word about Adelaide being a UNESCO city of music, because it is something absolutely, truly to celebrate. Thanks so much. Have a great day.
Thank you very much to the Lord Mayor for those really encouraging words about work that I think everybody here is probably engaged in doing. And now I'd like to welcome Peter Luca, the Executive Director of Arts SA, up to the stage to have a quick chat with you all as well.
Good morning, everyone. To the Right Honourable the Lord Mayor, Martin Hazy, the Deputy Lord Mayor, Megan Hender, to councillors, I'm not sure if I've seen Sandy Vashaw and Philip Martin this morning, but I assume they're here or about to be here. To Jack Buckskin, who's welcomed us to country this morning. To the international representatives from the UNESCO Cities of Music, Mr. John Wardell, Director of National Live Music Office, Ms. Hannah Brooks, the business advisor to the City of Melbourne, Vincent Ciccarello here from our prestigious Adelaide Symphony Orchestra, who have just finished right in the middle of some amazing performances with Saul, the opera. Anne Weiberg, the Chair of Music SA, Sarah Bleeby from UNESCO Cities and the Festival Centre, Beck Bates from our own Music Developments Office, the Honourable Tammy Franks, member of the Legislative Council. A very special welcome to you all, especially our international guests. I hope that you are enjoying Adelaide during this wonderful festival season. It really feels like I'm living a Beatles song at the moment. It's Hard Day's Night every night. And for the next month, it is non-stop. It is a relentless international capital Adelaide really is the festival capital of the world right now. We have the Adelaide International Festival on. We have the world's second largest fringe festival after Edinburgh. And this weekend we'll have, and I know many of you will be attending, WOMAD. I want to acknowledge also that the land we meet here today is the traditional lands of the Kaurna people. And the Kaurna people are the traditional custodians of the Adelaide region, and I would like to acknowledge their spiritual relationship with their country, and their cultural and heritage beliefs are still as important to the living Kaurna people today. Arts South Australia is the state government's arts agency. It's our role to ensure that the state recognises and capitalises on economic opportunities arising from diverse arts and culture in the state. A report released last month found that in 2015 and 16, our performing arts centre, the Adelaide Festival Centre, alone made an economic contribution of $107 million to the greater Adelaide economy. This report also highlighted the significant social contribution which encourages greater social cohesion in the community. The social contribution was valued by Ernst & Young, or EY as they're known now, as at $52.4 million to the city, bringing the total economic contribution to more than $160 million. In South Australia, arts and cultural heritage are worth over $1.5 billion to our state economy every year. But one of the jewels of all of this is, of course, music. It's the reason why we set up the unique music development office within the state government to bring together the creative and the industry development sectors to grow our local music industry and audiences for live music. We know that music is a driver of the creative and economic benefit to the state. It contributes $264 million to the local economy, and that's a 2014 figure, which provided over 4,000 jobs. Our music development office offers a suite of funding programs and strategic initiatives that not only ensures that we support and nurture artists to create great music, but that also provides platforms for music to connect with audiences locally, nationally, and internationally. We have an incredibly rich musical heritage here in South Australia, and we're quite proud of it, proud of the many artists who go on from here to achieve international success. For instance, if anyone was watching the Grammys last week, it was last week, I think, yes, time has flown, that the expatriate South Australian, Sam Dixon, was a winner of a Grammy Award with a co-write on the latest Adele album, and I think Adele was here on Monday. So just reinforcing that Adelaide is truly an international city. The list of artists is as long as it is diverse. It includes a lot of current artists like Sia Furler, TK Midza, Hilltop Hoods, Greta Bradman, following from some of the greats in our state like Paul Kelly, AC/DC and Cold Chisel. We value greatly our designation as a UNESCO city, and I just want to reinforce what the Lord Mayor has said, and we will continue to celebrate this. And we recognise that it's so much more than a recognition of our past, but also about our vision for the future. It is about how we will bring together in a global context all of this that will, and how we forge the new relationships and networks that you're all here to meet for with the UNESCO City Network to leverage opportunities that we collectively probably didn't think were possible before. So I just want to acknowledge again the delegates from UNESCO Cities Network, but also to mention that just down the road here, we have the International Festival Cities Network is also meeting in Adelaide this week. Last year, we ventured abroad with a program called Made in Adelaide. We took a showcase to Edinburgh festivals. We had over 90 delegates. We activated a hall in as part of the Edinburgh Fringe. Part of that was a music showcase. We had Adam Page, TK Midza, and Electric Fields to an audience of over 450 people. So we really see our posture is outward facing and really delivering Adelaide as a global city. We know that music connects people, it moves us, it tells our stories, it creates the soundtracks to our lives. And I think my first concert was 1927, if anyone remembers them. 2K. Well, yeah, well, touche. Fostering a strong music culture strengthens the heartbeat of our cities, and it filters out to enrich our communities, the spaces, and the places we live in. Conversations such as the summit you have today, arranged by the Adelaide City Council, and I commend them on their first summit, ensures that music and our broader cultural values continue to be highlighted as an integral ingredient to the urban and our social development. I wish you well for your discussions today. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much to Peter. That was great. And now I'm going to invite our panelists to head up towards the stage. That's you guys. and join me up here. And just while they're settling in, I'll remind you guys what we're talking about today. So our topic is the role of live music in the sustainable development of a city. And I think one of the things about our designation as a UNESCO City of Music is that it's not just about the music activity we have in the city, but it's actually about the way our different levels of government and our local industry put music at the center of our city's future. So the topic we're talking about today really goes to the heart of our designation of the live music as a live music city. Come on, guys, get up here. I can't introduce you till everybody can see you. Yeah, I'm gonna sit here. You can't sit here. This microphone's set up for like tall men, and then I'm here. Awesome. Okay, so I just want to introduce you to everybody who's done a very good job of getting on stage very quickly. Thank you, guys. Sitting immediately next to me is Rainer Kern. Now, Rainer's actually here all the way from Mannheim in Germany, so he's made quite the trek to get here. And that's even more impressive given how busy he is. He's probably one of the busiest people I've ever met. He started his life as a chemist, but he changed tack after studying chemistry to work in the culture realm, and we're very lucky that he did that. And if I listed all the things that he has done or is doing, we'd be here all day, so I've just picked a couple. He is the founder of Germany's biggest jazz festival, which is called Enjoy Jazz. He programs a lot of things that aren't jazz as well, just so you know. And that festival runs annually for 7 weeks over 3 cities, which is enormous. Simultaneously, he's also a representative of the Lord Mayor in Mannheim, and he authored the city's successful bid to become a UNESCO City of Music. So sort of one of our colleagues then. He's the director of that project in an ongoing capacity as well. And among other things, he's authored a university course that's now taught. He's the chair of Heidelberg's Kulturhaus Karl Storbahnhof EV. He can probably correct my pronunciation on that. and he represents the city of Mannheim in several international forums as well. And so he's very busy, and we really appreciate him being here today. Sorry, I meant to say, well, thank all our panelists for coming after I've introduced them all. So hold your applause. Next to Rainer, we have John Wardle. John joins us from Sydney, where he works in he's the director of the Live Music Office, which is a national body that's dedicated to creating more opportunities for live music across the country. John is known by absolutely everyone I've spoken to as the guru of policy and regulation around live music in Australia, but he's also a musician and a music teacher, so he is really keyed into what musicians and venues need too. And we're super grateful that he could be with us. Next to John, we have Hannah. Hannah's here from Enemy Country. She's from Melbourne. But she's actually very nice, which is surprising for us all. She's the music business advisor for the City of Melbourne. And that means she leads the development and implementation of the city's music strategy. So there's a lot we can learn from her. And previous to her current role, Hannah worked at Yamaha Music Australia. And before that, she's been in the film and television sector. So she has a huge wealth of knowledge we can draw on. Next to Hannah is Beck Bates. I've known Beck for a long time, and in my brain, she's always been the person who makes things happen for musicians in South Australia, which is kind of what her title is as well. Her title is Manager of Contemporary Music with Arts SA. And she's part of the music development office here. She works specifically on creative development and delivers funding programs to support artist development. And before working in government, Beck was part of the industry. She was part of a music management company, so she's got great perspective. And finally, all the way down the end there, we have the Deputy Lord Mayor of the City of Adelaide, Megan Hender. And Megan actually brings a really unique perspective, because as well as being a second-term elected councillor, she runs a business and lives in the City of Adelaide. And obviously that's a really important perspective when you're just discussing live music. She runs a consulting business, which she's done since 2002. And so between doing that and helping to run the city, she's managed to find time to join us today. So please welcome them all. I'm just going to use this microphone because I'm chronically short. So we're here to talk about how live music can help our city develop into the city we want it to be. And also, obviously, in order to do that, we need to help live music to grow first. So I wanted to start off by talking about kind of one of the key tensions in supporting live music in a city, which is, I guess, the residents versus venues question, which I'm sure we've all run into. And I'm directing this at Hannah because the City of Melbourne has been making a lot of policy around this particular tension for a few years. So I'm wanting to know what kind of constructive policy measures has the city found successful in balancing the needs of venues and people who are making a lot of noise with the needs of residents who are trying to sleep while that noise is being made?
Okay, thank you. So the City of Melbourne has a number of initiatives that we use.
Sorry, one second.
Hear?
Can you guys hear Hannah?
Can everyone hear all right? No, I come closer.
I can give you one of these, Hannah.
Yeah, that might be easier. Thank you. Can you hear me now? Yeah, great. So I think it's important that to include other events and busking into the scenario, because not just venues that residents will essentially make complaints about in relation to noise. So events such as Melbourne Music Week and all the other events that we hold in the City of Melbourne. So from a venue perspective, we have a number of initiatives at the City of Melbourne that would kind of push the venue to make efforts to minimise noise. One of those is the Melbourne Licensees Forum, which is run by our late night economy team, and that brings in the Victoria Police, the Australian Hotels Association, the Victorian Liquor Gaming Commission, the venues, and that's pushed towards more of the late night venues, your nightclubs, and those that will be operating maybe, you know, until the early hours of the morning. We also have, which we just started this year as part of our music strategy, we held our first Melbourne Venues Day last month, which was a huge success. We had 50 venues attend, and we ran that in collaboration with Music Victoria. And that addressed issues such as bringing in our planning team, our planning enforcement team, who would essentially be getting the noise complaints. So they were able to speak with the venues, let them know what the process was if they got a noise complaint from a resident. We also had Marshall Day Acoustics come in and do a fabulous presentation to the venue operators to let them know how they could properly sound attenuate their venue to mitigate noise. And that was really well received. And we also, Creative Victoria, have now got funding for soundproofing for venues. So we had a little case study on that from one of the successful venues in the city. So it was great to be able to share that with venue operators, and we got some really good feedback. Some other things that we have are the best practice guidelines with Music Victoria that are available for venues, and just ensuring that there is proper cohesion across council with residents association groups, precinct groups, and of course having someone like my good self to work across council to ensure that live music needs are met and the needs of the residents.
So I guess there's a lot of talk of conversation and collaboration in there, so everybody's part of the conversation to make things work. And there's a few regulations that you mentioned in there as well, but I wanted to bring John in here as our regulation expert. I was talking to John the other day, and he mentioned to me that South Australia has made some amazing leaps forward from a regulatory point of view recently and sort of leading the nation, he tells us, which is always nice. So John, could you start off by telling us about what's happening in the regulation sphere in relation to what Hannah was just talking about in terms of balancing the needs of residents and performers and audiences, and then just give us a quick run through of some of the other kind of major steps that have been made recently.
Right. Well, if we go back a little bit, South Australia delivered a strategic plan for their contemporary music sector. Just a few years ago, the Martin Elbourne and everybody involved in that tabled a plan for industry development. We saw the Music Industry Council established, and the council reviewed the plan and identified five priorities from that plan, essentially, which was then became... there was a lot of regulation that was identified through that. So a regulation roundtable was set up, and then we've seen 90-day change come through, and so there's been quite a structured process in how some really interesting things have been delivered in South Australia. There are some recent introductions in the regulation space here that don't exist anywhere else in Australia. We've seen the small venues variation to the National Construction Code introduced, nationally significant to provide a lower risk specification. I don't know if Noel Mensforth is here today from planning, but I think we should acknowledge his contribution there on delivering something that is the rest of the country is now looking towards. If we look to the Liquor Act, that was something that came through and commenced last year. There was also a fair bit done on the Liquor Licensing Act and the entertainment consent conditions that was a very serious barrier to activation in licensed premises, that every licensed premises in South Australia with entertainment needed to have that days, times, hours, instruments, even genres were specified on licensing, on liquor licenses.
I believe there was one venue where you could play a harp or a didgeridoo and that was it.
Indeed, yeah. indeed. And there was, you know, I think this became a something that everybody could recognise was an issue, and really focused attention on red tape. That, through the review of the Liquor Licensing Act, the removal of that provision has meant that entertainment conditions on liquor licences across the state are no longer in force. Now, that is something the rest of the country looks at and goes, wow, you've just removed entertainment conditions off every liquor licence in the state. That is, now, because you're able to do that because you had a separate provision in the legislation where that lived, other states don't have that entertainment consent, so they wouldn't be able to make that sort of blanket removal. So whilst it is, it was a serious problem, it's now been turned into something that's quite, that is a big achievement. We've also seen exempt development introduced here and commenced. These things are delivered. People talk about these things, there've been ideas, but nobody's actually introduced them. I think Kane Goldsworthy's here, I mean, what a serious achievement it is to have low impact entertainment no longer able to be required of development consent in land use. If we look to for people that look around the country and keep an eye on red tape issues that venues are having, you might have seen the Harold Park Hotel in Sydney feature in the news recently where entertainment was being held inconsistent with a DA condition. I mean, why? When a venue goes for to upgrade and do some capital works, council then takes the opportunity to put a DA condition on it, I don't know, but a particular long-standing venue. But if exempt development was in place in New South Wales, and then that venue wouldn't have gone through that pain. So there's more to this. It's not just about the regulation. It's also about the collaborative marketing. Lisa here from Music SA, Anne Weiberg, we've seen the umbrella collaborative marketing. We're also seeing the live music census, where every year you're mapping all the ecology. So there's a balance to how, and it's quite simple, really, when you look at the structures on how this is being developed.
Well, that's, I was getting a bit worried you're going to step on my toes for my next question there, but I think we're okay. It's actually interesting because I can, when you talk about the regulatory changes, we can see how broadly through both local government and state government, the cause of live music has been embraced. But it's something that I wanted to talk to Deputy Lord Mayor Megan Hender. Is it okay if I call you Megan? Yes. to Megan about, because I think there's a real need for live music ideas and decisions to filter through every level of government, you know, even in the maintenance part of the council. And how do you think that we can make sure that regardless of what decision is being made, live music is part of the thought process?
I think it's, can you hear that? I think it's a bit about sort of awareness raising, and which is one of the reasons why I was a strong advocate for this session. Awareness raising not just for the people who work in the industry, but for people who don't work in the industry. I was lucky enough to go to the Beijing City of Music of Creative Cities conference last year, and there met representatives from about 140 cities who are part of the Creative City things. And it wasn't really till I got there that I realised what a huge opportunity the City of Music designation is for Adelaide. And I think it's really important that we find ways that everyone in the city knows about that. And part of that is making sure that we're talking to people outside of the industry about it. I think within the administration that I work in, within the City Council, one of the things I'm really keen to see is that the City of Music designation is front of mind for everyone. So I want, and I think we're getting there, to be honest, so it's starting to happen. I want, when we are designing a playground, for us to be thinking, we're a City of Music, what will we put in our playground? When we're designing or we're thinking about our public art and what's in the public realm, we're a City of Music, how would that impact on what our public realm should look like? When we're thinking about what programs we run in our libraries, you know, how does the City of Music designation impact on that? So I can see how that works in the City Council, and I'm really interested for that broader conversation to happen with the state government and with corporations and, you know, with the city community more generally, so that we're thinking about how we embed it into our day-to-day life. And the other big issue for me is how we find other budget lines. Because if we can find a maintenance budget line rather than a music budget line, we're going to add to the amount of resources we can apply to this great opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that level of visibility that you can achieve by spreading responsibility for being a City of Music throughout all departments and levels of government will help with audience development, which I think is one of the key challenges for Adelaide when we talk about music. And it's something that I think I was interested in talking to Beck with. You had some ideas about how we could help audiences develop by developing the diversity of music that we think about when we run events and program festivals.
I think obviously audience development's huge, and it's not an easy, there's no gold key to an answer to that one. But something that I was really interested in is a bit that John referred to before, and there's been a deliberate pathway to making more live music happen, so for people to present live music and for people to experience it. And then Umbrella, as John referred to, is a strategy to fill the space. The diversity of that music, I think, is really important. And especially in the conversation this week with our friends from around the world. I mean, Adelaide, we have such a multicultural society here. And I think if there was an active approach to engaging multicultural musicians and audiences to participate, that would add such a different colour to the city, literally, but that possibly isn't strong enough at the moment. I know that our friends Nexus next door do an amazing job in this space. But I think there's a conversation that could be had. Melbourne did this really well, and I think we could probably lift our game here a bit more.
Well, actually, Reiner and I were talking about this last night, that for us to achieve things in the music realm, we need to make sure that the music is relevant to people. I think Reiner quoted a Smith song at me, which was great. But because Reiner does have that amazing international experience, I'm interested in hearing what he thinks are kind of the conditions we need to create for a city to be successful as a city of music.
I think you could tell me, because you're very successful. I could see that since I arrived on Sunday. Respect, big respect. No, first of all, I think from my experience, and that's more or less reflected on the panel here, you need a good strategy in your city, which must be made by politicians first. That's what I think. And very often it's one person, which might be the Lord Mayor, could be, because your speech was leading in this direction. And then you have, of course, in the decision-making process, you have to make a decision. And then I think the most important word then is balance, because when I take your four pillars that describes your city, I can sum them up maybe in a word which is very modern, urban, urbanity. Maybe you want to foster urbanity in your city, I'm just saying now. Maybe you do not agree. But when we come to a livable city, then it's a totally different interpretation as possible. Like the artist who wants to perform has a totally different point of view than the neighbor of the venue. So what you then have to bring in when your decision is made and your strategy is set up, hopefully with the majority of people in town, not only in the parliament, the local, you have to find the balance of all that. And as I've just learned on the panel here about what your strategy is, I can tell you you're the better Germans than we are. It's very, very well done. All the regulation organization, it's great. That's maybe your Lord Mayor has a German name. So, no, without regulation it's not possible. With only regulation it's not possible. So you have to find a balance, and I think that's very important. And if we're talking about sustainability, which is in the title of this session, I think sustainability is mainly and maybe only political will. But you can do whatever you want to. Your strategy can be as good in your regarding risk sustainability. If the parliament has another decision, then your sustainability is gone. So this has to be like a coming together. And at the same time, what Beck was saying regarding audience development, if you stay only in your tradition, then you will lose after a while your audience. That's quite what happens in Germany, or in whole Europe maybe in the minute. Because when we are talking about live music, I guess the majority here in the room has in its mind that we're talking about guitar-based music, what you're playing, or something we would call alternative independent rock, pop, whatever. But take in Germany, it's main. When you're talking about live music, only statistically, it's mainly Western classical music and opera. And as the society and the world itself is dramatically changing, it's no longer represented in the society in Germany, because it's totally diverse now. And let's say a third of the society in Germany, they didn't grow up with Western classical music or opera. That's not a complaint. It's just the situation that we find now. So what we need is a shift in what's presented on stages, a shift in what is presented on panels, for example, or in city councils. In Germany, we don't have statistically represented the society. So we have, let's say, 30% migrants, but in city administrations we have like 3% migrants working there or in leading roles. So if we are not aware of shifting our presented culture on stage, I think we will lose audiences, and that would mean we will lose live music experiences in towns. So I'm coming back to the crucial word, and that's balance. Balance in organizing the live music because live music is loud, we all know, and also what kind of music. And maybe I can, for the minute, a last sentence. And we never talk about quality of music. So that's, I think, we have to focus on that, and that means education in music. So we need music education, or in general, cultural education, arts education in schools, at universities, high schools, whatever.
There's a few things I wanted to pick up in what Rainer was saying there, but I think one of the most relevant things is if we are presenting music that doesn't appeal to our whole population or doesn't speak to all of them, that's certainly a problem in Germany, but it's more of a problem in Adelaide because we have a very small population and they're widely dispersed. So in our 2011 census tells us there was about 13,000 people living within the Green Ring. It's probably gone up a fair bit by now, but it's still a small amount of people who actually live in the CBD. We have about 200,000 people, I think, who come in daily, and we need to stop them leaving and keep them here to see live music. So what ideas do you guys have? Because we're going to need to get, you know, a buy-in of 60% of our population, maybe, to get a critical mass for big events, of our city population, that is. What ideas do you guys have to combat the low population issue in Adelaide? I'm going to call on Megan. She looks enthusiastic.
Look, we're working pretty hard on it. So is the state government. We recognise it as an issue, and we're trying to do all that we can to increase the population in the city. That happens organically, and there's no quick fix to it. But to your point about making sure we've got big enough audiences, have a look at the city this week. There is no doubt that if we put on, you know, events that are worthy of people coming, then people come in Adelaide in huge numbers. And all we do in Adelaide in February and March is add culture. That's all we do. And the city feels like a completely different city. So I think we see it as a challenge. There's all sorts of things we have to do to fix it. But as far as getting audiences in, it's as much about letting people know what's on as it is about actually people having... I mean, I don't think we need our audience to live right in the heart of the city in order to make it work. That's not what's happening this month, and it's highly successful.
This goes to something that came up in conversation when John and I were speaking on the phone. He was speaking about the strong radio culture in some of the other states. So independent radio that really encourages people to get out and see live music. And we have some great independent radio stations operating in South Australia as well, but they're probably not of the size and scope of some of the radio stations we see interstate. What other kind of integrated marketing visibility things can we do to make sure that people know things are on outside of February and March?
Do you want to speak?
John, have you got any ideas?
I would keep doing what you're doing. Umbrella is something that's inspirational for me, for the rest of the country. Also, that's something City of Melbourne do incredibly well. The Melbourne Music Week, the Live Music Safari, Hannah can speak to that. Melbourne is incredibly good at the activation. Just staying with Umbrella and just showing that the venues, the musicians, the city knows what's on and where. It's something I am being a pain about in the city of Sydney at the moment and really pushing to see, you know, when the venues are going through stress, what's the other messaging? So we're avoiding the cultural of crisis. We are celebrating the great venues and the great artists. There are other examples around Australia. If we look to City of Brisbane, Queen Street have regular Indigenous programming. And so there's some, you know, I don't see that sort of recognition in that way where every week pretty much you can go and see an Indigenous artist performing for free in the city. There's an opportunity here, I would think, and but yeah, I mean, just stay with it. Stay with it.
I guess it does take time for people to get the message out there.
Yeah.
I did have some conversation as well with Beck about some ideas around visibility and how we might be able to increase visibility even through engaging different kinds of art in showing the music side of the city, even public art.
Oh, yeah, well, a public art program with music focus would be amazing. Mm. That would be fantastic. I mean, you go into Nashville and you know it's not that I've been... You see photos of Nashville, if you haven't been there. You know it's a music city. You can see there's signs everywhere. There's, you know, some of them awful, some of them great. But you can feel it. You can see it everywhere. You don't get that sense here. So I think that, yeah, incorporating visual arts is a fantastic way. I mean, you're right, radio isn't the same as it used to be. You know, we can no longer necessarily go out and see in venues in town what we're listening to on the radio. It's a different world, so we've got to find different ways to engage. But we have a massive student population living in the city as well, international students. Surely there's a way to we could work more proactively to engage these people in our live music culture here. I mean, remember when Martin Elborn walked down the street a few years ago, the first thing he said is, who runs the K-pop festival here? You know, and there isn't one. You know, but it just seems there's some untapped audiences. But back to what John was saying, I think we are... It doesn't always seem obvious that there's a strategy for audience development in what we're doing, but it's sewn through every single thing that we do intrinsically to what we do. There's a reason for audience development in there. And it's a long game. There's no easy fix, but, yeah, it's definitely front of mind with everything, even to the work that we're starting to do with... councils outside of the CBD, and so regional development is imperative. There's so many audiences that outer metro and regional South Australia that we need to engage better with. And so for those that don't know, at the last AGM of the Local Governments Association annual meeting, there was a motion put up that all 68 councils across the state would consider developing some kind of live music action plan, and it passed without any
no dissent.
Yeah, so that's fantastic. So there's an interest and there's a goodwill, and back to what Reiner said, there is the political goodwill, and now's the time, and we need to keep driving forward with that.
I think one of the other key things that stands in our way is musicians being able to make a living. So musicians need to have a sustainable income for us to have a sustainable live music scene, because we need people to play on the stages. And it's a really hard thing to address from sort of a government point of view, because obviously you can't just go around handing out cash to musicians, so they'd probably really like that. So what can we do to make sure... I think I read the average income of musicians annually is between $7,000 and $12,000 a year, which is not enough to live on. I know there's been some difficulties for musicians who work as music teachers on the side recently due to increased child protection legislation. How can we get some money into our musicians' pockets? I'm going to call on Hannah because she hasn't said anything for a while.
Thank you. Look, this is something that comes up in conversation all the time, and it's really important to me. It's probably one of my strongest passions, because I do have a lot of friends who are musicians and see how unfairly they can get paid. What I ensure that I try to do in some of the programs at City of Melbourne is use a model where we're paying musicians, I'd probably say, above average rate. We don't currently have something across council that ensures that it's in all our events and programming, but it's something that I'm working on. We try to, and going back to activation where it ties in, been working to try and integrate live music into retail, into our bigger retail activities. So we would do an EOI process to curate that program. We've mainly been using our buskers because we have fabulous busking talent in Melbourne of our emerging talent, and we would recommend a rate for the retailers to pay. And essentially, a lot of the retail bigger chains would also have a bigger budget, so it's a great model to use. If I could just come back to some of the points while I am speaking, because Bex mentioned the international students. So next week in Melbourne, we actually hold at the City of Melbourne the Lord Mayor Student Welcome, which is done every year. And it's hugely successful. We have a huge international student population. And this year we're actually integrating it with Asia Topa. So on the 24th of March, we'll have the Asia Pop Fest, which will be held at the Sydney Meyer Bowl. And we are integrating the student welcome with that. And it is already just going off. If you can get a ticket, good luck. So that's one of the ways. Going back to what I've just spoken about in terms of retail, we use our What's On at City of Melbourne to really try and engage visitation to the city. So, and we try to engage our venues, all our events that are running in the city, with music programming, to list their events on there. And then we drive that from a tourism perspective to when visitors are coming, whether they're international, from outer suburbs or national, to enjoy the experience of the city. So you're going shopping, you're having breakfast at a cool cafe, you're having incredible Melbourne coffee, doing a bit of shopping, then you're going to see some live music, so it's a whole package. Or you're staying for the whole of Melbourne Music Week, whatever it might be. So that ties in with our tourism and our visitor economy there, so that's something you might like to take. Also, in terms of community radio, obviously we have a strong community radio in Melbourne. It's probably something that's quite unique to us, and I've spoken about it at other forums. We use Triple R and PBS throughout our programming. With Music Week, we would ensure that we'd have Triple R and PBS involved in that, and we would be promoting through those channels quite a lot. So people are hearing unique music on those stations, and they're hearing that they're tied in with our events, so that's how we support that. There's some tips for now.
Thank you from our big sister in Melbourne. I actually wanted to throw to Raina on some of those questions as well. I'd be interested, firstly, to hear from the German perspective, how do you make sure your artists are getting paid? And then if there's anything else you want to throw in there too, go for it.
How we make sure that the artist's getting paid?
Yeah, how do they make a living?
We have a very good law system in Germany. This is a very interesting discussion going on. Coming back to the traditional music, German traditional music, which is Western classical and opera. For example, at the big theaters where you have the symphonic orchestras based, they have contracts, of course. And they're organized in trade unions, which causes some quite interesting situations, let's say it like that. So if you ever worked with a symphonic orchestra, and I don't know if that's the same system in Australia, I hope not, and you say, well, that sounds quite okay, but the soloist from next Saturday, he's coming tomorrow morning, let's rehearse tomorrow morning at 10 again. Then they say, oh no, we now have to wait for 36 hours, and then we have to rehearse. We cannot do tomorrow morning 10. Then you say, but the soloist has to leave at 12. No, by law, we're not allowed to. So, and that's, when we're talking about creativity, and I totally agree to the Lord Mayor, that this is a crucial point in our society now, when we know that we're not saying that by purpose, it's research, we know that. So some of the laws are not quite going with creative processes. So, but anyhow, please allow me to be different now for a minute. Let's ask the question: How do we make sure that the baker is paid? Well, how do you make sure you go there and buy the bread there? Why do you buy the bread there? Because that's the closest bakery, or that's the best bakery. So. And I'm coming back to quality now. How do you make your decision whether you go to this concert tonight or not? And how do you make the decision whether you go to the concert A, B, or C if there are three in town? It's about what you like, and it's about what you expect. It's good. I'm reading my new poems tonight and playing the flute. Would you come? It will be very nice.
Give it a go.
You would not. I wouldn't go either. So, no, what I'm saying is, coming back to quality, it's really difficult. We all have the same aim. We want to have our artists paid, of course. But it's really difficult. You can take the same system we have with symphonic orchestras. You just give them contracts and they have to play a special amount of time of music a month. Or maybe that sounds not really familiar for us regarding music that's on that stage, maybe. So again, I think it has to be a system in town, coming back to what the town, what a city can do, that it's affordable to run a venue, so the taxes and the law has to be like, it's affordable, not that you have to pay all the taxes to the city council or to whomever. That's one thing, that's what you can provide from the city. And at the end, when you're promoting concerts, you have to do good marketing, you have to find a good balance of different styles and all that. And maybe we have to change the kind of arts we are presenting. So that's really, it's a question we all want to know the answer, but I guess the only answer is to find an audience for the arts you're presenting, because the audience is paying. It doesn't make sense to me that the government is paying artists, not 100%, of course they have to pay, like, if there's an ensemble at the theater, and I can understand symphonic orchestra and stuff like that, but that wouldn't work for all the arts, I guess. It's just you have to find your audience. And again, it's the promoter's choice to go with this changing society, and it's the government's choice to provide good education. That's what I think.
This issue of quality... Oh, sorry.
Can I jump in, Megan? My husband's a jazz fiend and has dragged me to jazz venues all over the world. Some of the best jazz I've ever seen is in Adelaide, free, in a pub. You know, one of the things I think... And there's been 12 people in the audience. So I think two of the keys to this is making sure that people know that person is on in that pub that night, making sure that the people who live nearby know it, making sure that the people who are coming into the city to work stay around because that bloke's playing and he is sensational, and making sure the people in the hotels, the Hilton and the, you know, all the people who are visiting us also understand that we've got someone really outstanding playing in that pub. But I also think it's about the artist saying, I don't want to play for free. You know, I'd pay for that. If it was happening in Denmark, I'd be paying $10 as I went in the door. It's given away here a lot. And I perhaps that's about giving artists the confidence to ask to be paid for. Like the bread maker doesn't expect you to go and take your bread home for free because you happen to, you know, be a bit of a bread fiend. You know, you expect to pay for quality. And I think we need to be giving our artists the confidence. And part of that, I suppose, is the audience development.
This goes to the heart of one of the real concerns that I have about how we can develop live music in Australia, which is in Australian culture, we don't value arts in the same way that they do in Europe. Rainer and I had a discussion about this yesterday. But there's obviously a lot of education to be done. People know that when they go to the football, they pay for premier seats, they pay high... prices for a pie, for a beer, because they know it supports something that they think is valuable. They know that footballers should get paid several millions of dollars per year to kick a football, which is an interesting choice. But we don't know that...
We don't close the ground if there's a noise complaint.
No.
If someone moves in next door.
And you can have live music at the Clipsal 500 until midnight. I heard every word of the Hilltop Hood set last Friday night.
Well, are those cars compliant with environmental protection?
Well, I think we wrote the compliance so that they would be. But I think this is a real problem. We like art, but we don't value it, and we don't think that we need to pay for it. And that is a deep-seated cultural issue that takes a lot to address. How can we speed up the process of fixing that? John, any ideas?
Go to gigs for a start, you know, go and see live music. I mean the competition for the entertainment dollar is an interesting challenge, but you know, I think when I look around the states and territories, Victoria has measured, has weathered the changes in leisure trends and technologies much better because they had a different regulatory background. They never had Pope entertainment planning approvals that New South Wales had. They had the small bars since 1986. These have only come into South Australia and New South Wales, for example, in the last couple of years. So if we look back to the 80s when Victoria changed its liquor licensing, then when football, for example, went from Saturday afternoon to Friday night, then there were all sorts of venues, different types of venues for the musicians to work in. Mm-hmm. In other states and territories, we didn't have those types of liquor licenses. There's still default prohibitions in Queensland on live music where you need a noise assessment and then a license condition if you're going to have live music in licensed premises. It doesn't apply to broadcast sport, for example. So there's an asymmetry in how, from a regulatory perspective, in how we have approached live music. Through that time, we've seen changes in leisure trends, technologies. We have digital, the internet. We've got all these wonderful things. Victoria had a different way because of their regulatory thing. They've measured it well. They're great with the public transport. The cultural, it's also the geography of cities as well, how people get around and how things are placed. So it's a very complex thing to reconcile.
I'm going to throw to you guys to ask some questions really soon. Can I get Danielle or someone to grab this microphone from me and take it down to the audience? Anyone, really. If you could just stand in the middle.
Could you sing?
quick performance from Sarah Bleeby now, everybody. Anybody who wants to ask a question, please head towards Sarah. Oh. Here we go. Go for it.
It's more a statement. I was just glad to hear about education in schools. I think it's easier to mould the malleable than change the old and crusty.
And that is something I wanted to return to anyway. So perhaps, Hannah, if you wanted to start by talking about, do you have any specific education programs happening in Melbourne that have been particularly successful?
Totally on topic. One of the projects I'm working on at the moment is... what are we calling it? Music education promotional video. So one of the things that came out of our music symposium was getting the tertiary education providers to work more collaboratively because they tend to work in silos. So we've brought them together to produce a video promoting Melbourne as a music education destination. So that will be promoted out internationally. So I'm happy to share that once it's complete with you all. But going back to, I suppose, Music Australia will be very strong in this area if you're talking about education in schools from a younger age. It's not something that I have a lot to do with in terms of primary and secondary school in City of Melbourne perspective, but I do know that we've just implemented one of our strategic partnerships with the Recital Centre, whereby they're having a preschool music program that will bring in lower socioeconomic communities in to enjoy music. So that's a couple of the ways that we're working with education.
And I think Ryan, I wanted to weigh in on this one as well.
Yeah, what I think is crucial, and since I arrived in Adelaide, I found out that it works very well here. In your city, as you said, the reputation of the arts is not that huge as it is for soccer or football. No, you don't play soccer. Football.
You play soccer badly.
Doesn't matter. We win anyway. Doesn't matter who's playing. but to create an atmosphere which is totally different, which is for the arts and which values the arts. And I experienced that from the very beginning when I arrived in Adelaide, which was early Sunday morning. The taxi driver already started to talk very proud about what's going on in Adelaide. You could immediately feel that here in Adelaide it's different. I mean, it's not 100% maybe in the population here, but I think that's if you value art by showing posters, like you have the flags everywhere, you have this, and you have the frame of a festival, which is even, which makes it easier than having a regular program in a club. So I think that's it. That's what a city municipality can provide, and therefore you need the mayors who are positive positive to culture and the arts. And if you create this atmosphere, I think that's a good starting point to get your art system better working. That's what I think.
I'm just going to throw to John as well on this, because he is a music teacher. Is that right? Yes. Do you think that education of young minds is maybe the point where we can change that Australian cultural issue we have around the arts?
I think it's a very important component. I was in the classroom on Monday night for a few hours. I taught at the Sydney Conservatorium of Music from 2000 to 2006 and was a guitar instrumental teacher and a program coordinator. I think having access to instruments for children, having encouraging literacy, encouraging participation is going to build literate audiences. It's going to build appreciation. I think it is somewhere where Australia's got a bit of catching up to do. I think it's been recognised in the Music Council of Australia, or Music Australia as it were, as they are now, play a really leading advocacy role there. So they would be, it's one of their core things. APRA AMCOS do great work as well. And there's also, musicians teaching in schools all over the place, creating wonderful bands of creative young people. So it's an essential priority.
Anybody else out there got a burning question? Yes? I don't know who has the microphone anymore, but if we could get it. Thanks, Felicity. Go ahead.
I'm a local resident, chairperson of the local South East City Residents Association. We have a holiday place in Victor Harbour, and we spend a bit of time down there, and we go to shows at the local, live music shows at the local bowling club, the local hall at Hindmost Valley, Inman Valley Hall. The local community gets together, and they get an artist from that travel around, and you see these artists, they'll go from country town to country town, but they don't come to Adelaide. And I was having a chat to one of them, a fellow called Greg Champion, and he was saying, well, you just don't get the publicity, and you get a hall and that sort of thing. In the city, we've got a lot of retired people, older people. I'm just wondering whether there's a place in, whether there is a place in Adelaide for sort of the community that are living in the city to just perhaps be attracted, or the council perhaps being the catalyst, to perhaps get some of these artists here and perhaps use the hall at the back of the Colonel Light Centre, the back of the town hall, and try and encourage some of these artists to actually, on their way through, to actually give a show like that, whereas a lot of people don't want to go, a lot of the older people. And when you go to these shows, there are a lot of grey-haired, like me, people there. But a lot of those people don't want to go to the pubs. They don't want to get their ears blasted, you know.
Okay, so the question's about whether, if we instituted some kind of community gathering point in the city, and it might be used as a lure for artists to come through, and also as a place where different kind of audiences might feel more comfortable. And I think that Megan is probably well-placed to answer that.
Look, I think the City Council will be really pleased to do that. We provide the hall at the back of Town Hall as a free free rehearsal venue for anybody who wants to have a rehearsal space, because there's no residents around and that's available to anyone when they want to use it. I'm sure we'd be, without wanting to bind my council, I'm pretty sure we'd be happy to also provide it as a performance space. And of course we've got community centres and libraries and a number of buildings across the city that would make for good spaces, and I'm sure would be rentable at either at a very low rent or no rent at all. The issue, I think, is finding those people and letting them know that that is available to them. And I think that's going to be part of the trick, isn't it? It's tracking them down and saying, come along.
So Ryan is just going to weigh in and then we'll throw back to the crowd.
I just want to add one thought or one point. When we're talking about education, or when I'm talking about education, and then I'm not only talking about learning instruments and playing live music, I'm talking about what became very crucial in our days, how to manage a venue, for example, how to manage a band. So I think cultural management, which is now named cultural management, is very important that we have people out there. They know how to make contracts. They know the law system. They know how to run a venue. And they know marketing, communication, and all that. They know how to connect to the local people, to make connections internationally, locally. I think, and you can learn that. You can learn playing the violin. You can also learn that. And I think if we're not connecting to that, because when we're asking how can we make sure that our artists are paid, then that's economy. So we need people who are connected to economy also. So I think that's very important. I don't know whether you can study cultural management somewhere here in Adelaide or in Australia. It became very famous, and a lot of universities now offer that in Germany, which is very important, I guess. Because when I started 25 years ago, and went out of the university where I studied chemistry, and I started in this cultural center, we were named, what I've learned yesterday, and I like it, we were named Latte Sipping Lefties. I've just learned it.
This is the one thing I managed to teach Rainer.
Maybe I will introduce that in my opening speech of my festival this year. Welcome, you latte sipping lefties. That would be fun in Germany saying that. I will bring that back home, that word. And others I learned from Sarah. I'll tell you, I don't tell you now, it's too rude. quality also in that field.
Just going to let John have a go at this one as well.
Look, just returning to artists getting paid. In New South Wales, I've got a project that we are rolling out across the state, Western Sydney and regional New South Wales, where we've got $400,000 that is going specifically to artists. And through an EOI process, we've already got the Western Sydney strategy going. 13 councils in Western Sydney. They competed for five. We're going to choose five. Each of them were going to get $30,000 to put on a little precinct event, and that money went to the artists, production and curators. So the councils that were going to work the hardest to activate a strip, a block, some shops, some retail, some licensed premises, public domain, would get $30,000 to pay for the artists. We had that first tranche is commenced. Wallandilly Shire have done theirs. Parramatta had their event just a few weeks ago. We've got another $100,000 for Western Sydney. We've got $150,000 for regional councils. So councils across New South Wales are competing against each other to put on little precinct events, and the state government pays for the musicians. So there's a interesting strategy to get local government connecting with pubs and clubs, connecting with local artists, plugging into the better regulation work that's happening around the country. They're all across what you're doing here, I can tell you, because that's part of what's happening. They're being supported to put on events, but also they're getting access to the best practice work that's happening around the country, what the City of Melbourne are doing, the work happening at the state level. So, yeah, interesting. Where did the money come from? Yeah. The money came from the New South Wales state government. It came from the former arts minister, Troy Grant, who's the Nationals, leader of the Nationals and part of the coalition in New South Wales. So it's Liberal Mike Baird, his government at that time. Since then, we've seen a change of premier, but there you go. It's great to see Liberal Nationals getting behind great live music policy.
In journalism for you, I think. We've got time for one more very quick question. So if you can make the question quick and we'll make the answers quick. Thank you.
I think it's not going to be so quick. Sorry about that, but I'll do my best. I think I have a unique situation because I am a professional songwriter and I have been living from my music for 3 years. I live in Mannheim, Germany. I'm from Adelaide and I come back to Adelaide every summer to get away from Mannheim's winter. And I think audience education is a huge problem in Australia and especially in Adelaide. I think in my experience that the front bar culture doesn't serve artists, it doesn't serve musicians to come together with a meaningful, attentive crowd. And I believe that there are these audiences out there and I believe that they want to meet with their artists. My question to you or something to contemplate is, how are you looking at your audience segments? How are you finding these audience segments? And how are you activating new spaces that are not the front bars, that are not the existing clubs, to bring together this hungry audience with artists like myself who want to play to that hungry audience? Thank you.
That's a great question. Who wants in? I'm happy with anyone, really. Beck, let's do it.
Look, I think there's a tension there. I mean, we want venues to have a vibe, and so there are lots of venues that do or do not pay artists to do the front bar culture because they want music in their front bar. They want people to come and enjoy the music. And there's a tension there. A lot of those venues, or some of those venues have band rooms, and then, you know, then there's paying gigs. And then it comes back to the quality. You've got to be great. You've got to have an audience, and it's that formula. And I went completely back to what I was going to say next. In terms of venues, I mean, some of the work that John was talking about before, what that means is some of the low impact licensing changes to support low impact events will enable more spaces that aren't front bars to host live music, and people can decide whether they put a ticket on the door or not. And so I think there is, they don't have to be traditional live music venues, they don't have to be front bars. It can be a vacant space that you negotiate with the building owner. It could be a laundromat. You know, there is other models that you could look at to do that kind of thing.
Yeah, I think there's some really great information about some of the regulatory changes that have been made to allow different kinds of venues to host live music on the Music Development Office website and on the Live Music Office website. Music SA website, there you go, sorry. We're probably going to have to wrap it up there, but can I ask you all to give our panel members a really warm thank you for their time. I think we have some official thank yous for them that might be forthcoming as well. Yeah, lucky guys. And I'm also going to introduce everybody to Sean McNamara, who is the Associate Director of Community and Culture for the City of Adelaide, and he's just going to finish us up with some final words.
Thank you, Farron. I appreciate that. Thank you to everyone for today. This is a really important input for us in the development of our live music action plan at the City of Adelaide and indeed in our cultural strategy as well. So we really appreciate everyone giving up their time. It seems a little while ago now, but I'd like to thank Corey for his performance at the beginning and Jack for his welcome to country as well. That was great. And also the Lord Mayor and Peter for their opening remarks. Naturally, special thanks to the panel for their time and their wisdom today. Really fascinating conversation, and hopefully everyone got something out of that. I'm really fortunate at the City of Adelaide to work with a fantastic, committed team who've done a lot of work to set today up, and I did want to thank them for their efforts today. So to Pip, Felicity, Danielle, Sarah and Anne, thank you very much for your efforts today. And very importantly, and certainly not leastly, Farron, for her excellent efforts today. Not just today, but a lot of work involved in working with the panel members, discussing through the topics done in the background. It was fantastic. Thank you very much.
I did it.
Excellent. Now, so that concludes the formal panel session. We've got some morning tea for people, which will just be out in the bar area shortly. For those who are hanging around and participating in the workshop, please do so. That'll be immediately after morning tea. And for those who just want to continue conversation with colleagues and peers and so forth, please feel free to utilise the courtyard outside. But thank you very much.